Good morning. Welcome to Incarnation. My name's Liz Gray, and I'm one of the pastors here. And it's lovely to see you all gathering, gradually bringing out your quilts and your chairs and all the things that we need in Canopy Church. So can I invite you all to stand? If you don't yet have one, you need a BCP and you need a song sheet. And in your BCP, you'll be starting on your Book of Common Prayer. You'll be starting on page 123. And if you look at your song sheet, right at the top of the song sheet, it's got a couple of page numbers. It's got the page, I actually haven't got mine here, but it's got the page number for the psalm. It's got the page number for the collect. And so it's a useful thing for you to have to hand as we go through the service. But I'll try and give you page numbers as we go through. So right now, turn to page 123. And we'll focus our minds. Inhale and exhale. And give thanks that we can worship together under the canopies this morning. Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever.
Amen. Let's pray together for our hearts. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. O my soul, praise him, for he is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear now to his temple draw near, join him in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord who doth prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely his goodness and mercy shall ever attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do, who with his love doth befriend thee. Praise to the Lord who when tempests their warfare are waging, who when the elements madly around thee are raging, biddeth them cease, turneth their fury to peace, whirlwinds and waters assuaging. Praise to the Lord who when darkness of sin is abounding, who when the godless do triumph all virtue confounding, sheddeth his light, chaseth the horrors of night, saints with his mercy surrounding.
What a lovely version of that hymn. There's some verses in there which I don't think I've come across before. So that was lovely. Let's turn to page 620 for the collect of the day. 620. We're in proper 21. The year is moving on. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray together. O merciful Lord, grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now let's pray for our children. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for our children, whether they're in person here or on Zoom. We're grateful for them, and we love that prayer that they will learn, like all of us, to serve you with a quiet mind. And when there is so much noise and bustle around us, Father, learning to have a quiet mind is such a gift. And so we pray for our children. Will you teach them what it means to engage with you when their minds are quiet? Amen. And now, with gusto.
I was going to say, if any of the kids want to come up and help us lead this one for the echo, that would be great. Otherwise, Beth and I will do our very best. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice.
A reading from Numbers chapter 11, verses 4 to 6. The rabble among them had a strong craving, and the Israelites also wept again and said, "If only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we used to eat in Egypt for nothing, the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up, and there is nothing at all but this manna to look at." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please join us in praying Psalm 19 responsively by whole verse. I'll pray the odd verses, and Lottie and you will respond with the evens. The psalm may be found on page 291 of your BCP. I'll give you a second to find it. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork.
One day speaks to another, and one night gives knowledge to another.
There is neither speech nor language, and their voices are not heard.
But their sound has gone out into all lands, and their words to the ends of the world.
In them he has set a tent for the sun, which comes forth as a bridegroom out of his chamber, and rejoices like a strong man to run his course.
It goes forth from the uttermost part of the heavens and runs about to the end of it again, and there is nothing hidden from its heat.
The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the simple.
The statutes of the Lord are right and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure and gives light to the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey, than the drippings from the honeycomb.
Moreover, by them is your servant taught, and in keeping them there is great reward.
Who can tell how often he offends? Oh, cleanse me from my secret faults.
Keep your servant also from presumptuous sins, lest they get the dominion over me. So shall I be undefiled and innocent of great offense.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
A reading from James chapter 4, verses 1 through 12. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are at war within you? You want something and do not have it, so you commit murder. And you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly, in order to spend what you get on your pleasures. Adulterers, do you not know that that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you suppose that it is for nothing that the scripture says, God yearns jealously for the spirit that he has made to dwell in us? But he gives all the more grace. Therefore it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning, and your joy into dejection. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. Do not speak evil against one another, brothers and sisters. Whoever speaks evil against another or judges another speaks evil against the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver and judge who is able to save and to destroy. So who then are you to judge your neighbor? The word of the Lord.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. This is the holy gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark. Glory to you, Lord Christ. John said to him, Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us. But Jesus said, Do not stop him. For no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. But if any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and if you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and to go to hell to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It's better for you to enter life lame than to have two feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and to be thrown into hell where the worm never dies and the fire never quenched. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. You can have a seat. So first, just a sound check. Can those of you at the back hear me all right? Okay, I'm getting some iffy. James, could you turn the speakers up a little bit? Or maybe my mic. We'll figure it out. Just come and let James know if you can't hear me. And same goes to you on Zoom. Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Amy, and I'm one of the pastors here. And it's good to be worshiping together here under the canopies and on Zoom. Let us know if you can't hear us. For kids ages 3 to 6, give or take, we have atrium on the quilt. So younger kids are welcome to go over there and find something to work on while I'm speaking. But also, I have a question for the kids. I wonder if you have ever seen a movie or read a book that has a character that has to choose between good and evil, who maybe has some kind of battle going on within themselves to try and decide what they're going to choose. It might even be that, like, the fate of everything hangs on what they choose. And so I just invite you to think about a story where you've seen that play out. Think about a character like that. And while I'm talking, you might want to draw a picture or paint a picture of that character. And then please come and show me and Liz and really any of us grown-ups afterwards so that we can learn from what you were thinking. But that idea of being at war within ourselves, this idea of a battle between evil and good inside of us, that's at the heart of today's passage from James 4 that Caitlin read just a couple minutes ago. And in real life, that kind of war within us isn't as clear or as obvious as what we see in movies and in fairy tales and in some of our favorite books. And that's why those stories are actually really helpful to us, because they take what's kind of subtle and hidden and invisible inside of us and they make it plain for us to see. And James is trying to help us see as well. So in chapter 4, just like all through James, he is using this really strong and vivid language, even maybe a little bit harsh language. And here, James sounds a lot like his brother. He sounds like when Jesus is using harsh and vivid language, when Jesus says things that sound like judgment, things that make us feel uncomfortable, things like the gospel passage I just read from Mark. And when we hear James or Jesus or the Old Testament prophets speaking to us this way from Scripture, it's appropriate that we feel a little uncomfortable, that we get kind of uneasy and squirm in our seats a little bit. But James is not going to leave us there. He's not going to let us just shift uncomfortably in our chairs. He's ultimately going to hold out a word of grace. So let's read what he says. Reading from verse 1, he says, "Those conflicts and disputes within you or among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are at war within you?" And those conflicts and disputes that James is talking about are what he's been writing about all through his chapter. Fights in the church, fights in the world, envy and selfish ambition, all the kinds of evil things that happen when people use their words to slander and lie and to abuse others, all the kinds of evil things that happen when the rich exploit and abuse the poor, all these conflicts, all this violence, and we don't have to look far to see that is the world that we are living into. But James is saying that all those conflicts out there, all of the world's violence and warfare and raging, it all actually begins in here. So reading from verse 2, he says, "You want something and you do not have it, so you commit murder. And you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts." James is getting right to the heart of what makes each one of us do what we do. He's getting to our longings. He calls them cravings. James is drilling down to our desires, to our wants. And at the core of our being, who we are, is what we desire, what we want. And the first question of discipleship is, what do you want? Jesus asks that in his Gospels again and again, using different words sometimes, but over and over he confronts people and asks them, what do you want? What are you hungry for? What are you thirsting for? What are you longing for? What do you want? And that's what James is getting at here when he talks about these cravings, these desires at war within us. Because we were created in the image of God to want what God wants. We were made to desire what God desires, to love what God loves. We were made to crave a world where God is all in all. A world that is ordered by goodness and truth and beauty and justice and mercy. A world that the scriptures call the kingdom of God. And even the law in this kingdom is a matter of wanting. It's a matter of desiring. Because as Jesus tells us and as James keeps repeating, and as how we say every Sunday, the law of this kingdom is a law of what we love. The core of the law is loving God and loving our neighbor. The law is about what we want, what we desire. And all of our actions flow from there. But we rarely go through a second or a nanosecond of any moment of any day where with our whole being, what we want and love most is God himself and the good of our neighbor. It just doesn't happen. And so that good love that we were made for, the good desires that we were made to have, they're distorted. And that distortion is what the Bible calls sin, and it enters both through our own sins and the sins that have been done against us, things that harm us, things that have done damage and created that distortion. And this sin distorts our wants. It distorts our loves. It puts us at war within ourselves, where our cravings are fighting one another. And so rather than loving God, loving our neighbor, longing for his kingdom, we begin to love other things, lesser things. We love our selfish ambitions. We love money. We love power. We love control or fame or praise. And James says that all these distorted loves then drive us to lash out, to try to manipulate the world and the people around us to give us what we want, to give us those distorted things that we want. And he compares this to committing adultery against God and being God's enemy. He's saying we are cheating on God because we are loving things that are less than him, things that will not be as good for us as he is. And then we are out there doing violence in the world, trying to get them for ourselves. But there's good news here, because James also says we actually can't out-desire God. We can't out-want or out-love God. In verse 5, he says that God yearns jealously for the spirit that he placed within us. God desires us. God yearns jealously for the spirit he placed within us. God is longing to be one with us again. God is longing to be reunited with us when we have wandered too far from home. God desires us. God loves us. And that yearning and that desire of God toward us, that is what makes us able to love and desire God ourselves. That is what moved God to come in the person of Jesus, to dwell in human flesh, to live that law of the kingdom, to teach that law of the kingdom, and then ultimately to put all those distorted loves to death on the cross. God's desire for us is overcoming us. It is making us people who are able to desire him and his kingdom again. And then verse 6 says that God gives all the more grace. However distorted the things we love, God is always giving more grace. So how do we receive that grace? How do we step into that? Let me read the full verse 6. James says, "But he gives all the more grace. Therefore, it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble." Therefore, God gives grace to the humble. Humility is what puts us in the pathway of God's grace. Humility is what lets us receive what God has for us. And James in this chapter gives us a lot of ways of practicing humility. So the first one of these is asking. It's asking God in prayer. So James says, you do not have because you don't ask. You ask and you don't receive because you ask wrongly. Asking God is this act of humility. It's this simple way of coming to God, not as people in control, but as people who are asking, who are receiving. It is this humble way of saying, we are needy. You are the giver and we are the receiver. So humility begins with just asking God for what we want. And I think it's important because sometimes this verse gets a little twisted up in our minds. It's important to notice what James is not saying here. Because he's not saying, don't ask God anything until your motives are pure and you're asking for the right thing. He's not saying, get your act together before you draw near to God. James actually makes clear that God can sort all of that stuff out for us when we ask. He assumes we are going to be asking, and that that is the place where if there are motives and if there are wrong longings, distorted desires, God can sift all that out. And so when you notice yourself wanting something, whether it seems like a good something or a bad something or a really important something or just a silly, frivolous something, ask God for it. Just ask. Just come with humility. Notice what you are longing for. Notice your cravings and ask for them. And then God can sort out. He can say yes or no. He can show you what is beneath those wantings and those longings. God will sift through it. But the first way that we come to God with humility is just by asking. And then in the last few verses of this passage, James gives us all these other ways to practice humility. He says, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy into dejection. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. And what James is calling us to here is sadness. We all have distorted longings for all kinds of reasons. And the call that James puts on each one of us is to notice what's there, to ask things, and then to feel sad where we see distortions in ourselves. To feel sad when we encounter the things that we are craving that are not good. Not to feel ashamed, not to feel self-loathing, not to suddenly feel motivated to pull ourselves up by our bootstraps and fix it, but just to notice and to feel sad. And then God always meets us in that sadness. Where we have distortions, where we are grieving our own warfare inside, God always meets us there. God always gives more grace. God is always yearning for us more than we can yearn for him or for any other thing. God is there to strengthen our love for what is good and to loosen our grip, our love for what is not. And that's just the ongoing rhythm of the life of discipleship, the life of a Christian. It's this upside down way of living where the way up is down, where the path to exaltation is humility, where the path to joy runs through lament and grief. So just over and over and over, day by day, we humbly bring ourselves to God. We humbly bring our internal warfare to him, and we ask him to set us at peace. And over, as we lament, and as he gives more grace, God brings all of our distorted wants into alignment with his good wants. By his grace, he is transforming us into people who love God and who love our neighbors. So James presents the brokenness in this world as sort of these concentric circles, as these ripples that go out in the water, but at their center is the brokenness in us. Why are there conflicts in the world? Why is there fighting? Why is there brawling? Why is there so much hatred and violence? Because there is a conflict in each one of us. There is a warfare in us that God is longing to set at peace with his grace. Well, earlier I asked you to think about a movie or a story where there's a character who has this kind of internal struggle between good and evil. And this week, as I was listening, my son and I have been listening to The Two Towers, which is part of the Lord of the Rings series. We've been listening on Audible in the car to and from school. That is a very slow way to get through a very long book. So we're in like year two of listening to this. But I was really struck this week with the creature Gollum and the way he exemplifies the themes that we see here in James 4. Because Gollum is really a double-minded creature. Gollum is internally torn between his craving for evil power and his craving for mercy. So much that Gollum actually refers to himself as we and us. He has sort of two tones of voice, two ways of speaking, two demeanors. One is pitiful and longing to be treated mercifully. And the other one is cruel and domineering, strategizing and sneaky, always trying to get control, always trying to scoot closer to evil and to power. But Gollum meets Frodo and Sam, two hobbits, these creatures who represent all that is good and peaceful and quiet and beautiful in the world. And Gollum himself was actually once a hobbit. But years of loving this evil power have distorted Gollum so that he is just so at war. And so when they meet, Frodo and Sam are on this quest to save the world against this growing darkness. And even though Gollum is their enemy, they show him this incredible mercy. They show him this incredible gentleness. And they take Gollum on as their guide. They tie him with a rope that was made by elves, which in this universe are these good, lovely, angelic creatures. And when this rope touches Gollum's skin, he shrieks, he cries out in pain. He says, "It freezes, it burns, it stings us." But this rope is actually tethering Gollum to his only hope in the world. It's tethering him to the only creatures that want to show him mercy and that are treating him with gentleness. And it's taking him on the path to the renewal of the world, to the restoration of everything that is good and true and beautiful. They're taking him on the path toward life and goodness. And the grace of God is like that rope for all of us. It tethers us to God's kingdom. It takes us on the path to want what is good, to love what is good. But sometimes when it touches us, even gently, it hurts. Sometimes receiving God's grace makes us lament and mourn and weep. Sometimes purifying our hearts hurts a little bit. But if we will humble ourselves, if we will allow ourselves to be gently tied by this rope, God in his grace will lead us toward his kingdom, will lead us on this path of love. So let's pray. God, we confess that we are people with cravings at war within us. And we ask that you would come and set us at peace. Father, as we enter this time of silence, we pray that your Holy Spirit would just be quietly ministering your grace to us, quietly tethering us to you, to the good things that you have for us. Amen.
weakness. Come rescue me, oh Lord. For you are my hope, and your promise never fails me. And my desire is to follow you forever. For you are good, for you are good, for you are good to me. For you are good, for you are good, for you are good to me. I cry out for your hand of mercy to heal me. I am weak. Lord, I need your love to free me. Oh Lord, my rock, my strength in weakness, come rescue me, oh Lord. For you are my hope, and your promise never fails me. And my desire is to follow you forever. For you are good, for you are good, for you are good to me. For you are good, for you are good, for you are good to me.
Let us together confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. And we're back in the Book of Common Prayer, now on page 126. So page 126 of your BCP. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated as we pray.
For the prayers of the people, I will pray, Lord, in your mercy. And please respond with, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, as James 4 tells us, we pray that you would help us to regularly submit ourselves to you. We pray that you would help us to make wise decisions on what we think about, reflect on, and surround ourselves with. Enable us to resist the devil for your love's sake. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the Universal Church, its members, and its mission. We pray for our Bishop John Guernsey and Archbishop Foley Beach. We pray especially for Bishop John and his wife Meg as they look to the future, and we pray for the new bishop's search. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our rector, Liz, and Amy, and Quatley, and David, and Katie. We pray that you would enable them to serve us well and to lead us spiritually. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our country and all those in authority, including our President Joe, our Vice President Kamala, our members of Congress, and all of our local government officials. We pray that you would grant them wisdom as they seek the public good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray today for the people of Honduras. We pray that you would move in a powerful way to address the root causes of gang violence and gender-based violence that drives many to migrate to the U.S. We pray for the churches there, that they might be an effective spiritual and social witness to the gospel message. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our sister church, Corpus Christi Anglican in Alexandria, and Rector Morgan Reed. Please enable them to fulfill your larger mission for them in Alexandria. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our own church community, that you would bring healing, wholeness, and peace to those suffering in body, mind, or spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Now let us go to page 130 for the confession. Now let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor, first in silence, and then together aloud. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Take a moment to greet those around you and those on Zoom. And we have our two newest babies are both with us today. So welcome to Anastasia and to Fletcher. Very exciting. Okay, there is so much jolly greeting going on now, but some of that might have to wait until after the service, where there'll be more time to meet and greet. Well done, Catherine. You're paying attention. Can I encourage you all to stop being so friendly now? Stop being friendly. Sit down. A very warm welcome to all those who are visiting with us this morning. If you are visiting, welcome. And also, our friendly ushers have got little blue cards. And if you are visiting and would like to fill in a little blue card so that we can touch base with you and let you know more about what's going on, just give a wave or ask an usher to give you one of those cards, and we'd love to be in touch. Right, and then today, I mean, whether or not you are a long-term incarnation person or a visitor, I would like to encourage you to, if you can, linger for the parish meeting, which is happening immediately after the service. We'll have a little bit of stretch time briefly after the service, and then we'll head into the parish meeting. We've got a couple of really important things that we'd like to talk to you about and get your opinions on. So if you can stay, please do. We would. I think it'll be an interesting time. In fact, there's lots of lingering after the service happening in the next few weeks, because next week, October the 3rd, is Donut Sunday. So everybody can bring some kind of like munchy, crunchy, snacky, brunchy kind of stuff, and we stay and we eat together for a while and chat. And also we're going to have another opportunity to talk a little bit more next Sunday after the service, just informally, a little question and answer. So do, again, bring some food and come and eat next week with us. And then a couple of weeks after that, just another reminder that David is getting ordained, yoo-hoo, on October the 17th. And the bishop is coming. And so what we've invited the bishop to do is also to linger after that service. Some of you, as Darren prayed a minute ago, will have heard that he has recently announced his retirement, which doesn't happen until, I mean, he won't step down until February 2023. It's a long, slow process getting a new bishop. But you might want to just come and love on him a little bit on October the 17th and ask him questions and get all that information out of his brain. Small groups are up and running, and so if you're not in a small group yet, this is my last reminder to you to see if you can join one. There are four happening, and there's more information about those online. Just sign up and join in. It's a good place to be known and to get to know others. Conscious that there is much to lament in the world, we are having an evening of lament and prayer on October the 8th. Kim is graciously going to host that, and we're going to have a variety of things available for you, like art materials, but you don't have to be an artist, just a space to pray, to draw, to write a poem, to just be together. And so you're very welcome. There are more details about that as well. But Kim, perhaps you could just wave, and then if people want to know more, you can ask Kim after the service. The Falls Church let us know this week that they are starting a confidential small group for men and women who are seeking healing after abortion. If that is something which you feel would touch your life or somebody you know, please feel free to spread the word about that. It'll be a very thoughtful and careful and good course, and I can warmly recommend you to go to that. After the service, there'll be atrium by the fence for the six pluses. So it'll be somewhere over there. So just look for the quilts and Josie, and she's going to be over here. So feel free, if you're six plus, to join in on that. And now an opportunity. Have any of you got any testimonies that you want to bring? Something where you've seen God at work or where you've seen God moving in the last week or two? Any quick testimonies? Okay, next week, people, I want some testimonies. So could you please pay attention this week as to what's going on around you? Because God is doing stuff. So just pay attention. Oh, okay, Catherine, come on, Catherine.
All right. As many of you know, I have a client on death row in Alabama who I sometimes fly down to visit and discuss his case and what it looks like to try to convince courts that his trial counsel didn't present everything that should have been presented. And we were going to have a really hard meeting this week talking about some really tricky things from his childhood. And I know you guys prayed about it at midday prayer, and that meant a lot. And we were able to have the discussion that we needed to have and make a lot of progress on how to present his case to the court. So thank you for your prayers.
Thank you, Catherine. Let's pray briefly. Lord, we thank you that you care at your deepest core about justice. I thank you for the work that Catherine does, and we pray for this gentleman that his cause will be heard. We thank you for the ways that you work and act, that you use us as your hands and feet to go into hard places. You bless and protect Catherine and the team as they continue to work diligently. Amen. And now as we come to the table, I invite you to prepare your hearts. And also, if you want to give, there are opportunities to do so. It's all on your song sheet. It's all online at this point or by text. And now let's quieten our hearts as we sing and as we come to the table.
You can all stand if you'd like to.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee, swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from thee, filled with messages from thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as thou shalt choose, every power as thou shalt choose. Take my will and make it thine, it shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine all, it shall be thy royal throne, it shall be thy royal throne. Take my love, my Lord, I pour, at thy feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee, ever only all for thee.
We're on page 131. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. All things come from you, O Lord, and of your own have we given you. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, worthy, worthy, worthy is the Lamb, the King of glory. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord, the only one who was and is and will come, the only one who was and is and will come.
Please have a seat. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had sinned against you and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the chalice, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is given for you, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify us also, that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us with all your saints into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast Alleluia. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same, Lord, whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us your peace. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. I'm going to invite the servers to come on up. I think we've got Sophie and Asher and Inez and the grown-ups. A reminder that this table is open to all who are baptized and following Jesus, and there'll be three stations, two at the front and one at the back. The one right at the front here with me will be where you can also get gluten-free. So if you're gluten-free, if you could make your way to this front one, even if it's not the obvious station for you. And if you would like to come forward but not take communion, just cross your arms. We would be delighted to pray a prayer of blessing over you. And you may just want to stay in your seat. And of course, that's perfectly acceptable as well. But if you'd like communion brought to you, just wave and we'll make sure that we do that.
When the fields are dry and the winter is long, blessed are the meek, the hungry, the poor. When my soul is downcast and my voice has no song, for mercy, for comfort, I wait on the Lord. In the harvest feast or the fallow ground, my certain hope is in Jesus found. My lot, my cup, my portion sure, whatever comes, we shall endure. Whatever comes, we shall endure. On a cross of wood, his blood was outpoured. He rose from the ground like a bird to the sky, bringing peace to our violence and crushing death's door. Our Maker incarnate, our God who provides, in the harvest feast or the fallow ground, my certain hope is in Jesus found my lot, my cup, my portion. Sure, whatever comes, we shall endure. Whatever comes, we shall endure. When the earth beneath me crumbles and quakes, not a sparrow falls, nor a hair from my head. Without his hand to guide me, my shield and my strength, in joy or in sorrow, in life or in death, in the harvest feast or the fallow ground, my certain hope is in Jesus found, my lot, my cup, my portion. Sure, whatever comes, we shall endure. Whatever comes, we shall in the harvest feast or the fallow ground, my certain hope is in Jesus found, my lot, my cup, my portion. Sure, whatever comes, we shall endure. Whatever comes, we shall endure.
Let us give thanks for the meal we've just had on page 137. 137. Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son, and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. And now, just before I give the blessing, often in the life of a community, there are comings and goings, and today we're just going to pray for Jeff. Jeff is one of our absolutely founding members of Incarnation. He's been invaluable over the last 4 years, absolutely pillar of the community, and that's not just because he's the tallest person, but he is useful in so many ways as our feaster and delighter in all things good. And the Lord is calling him to serve his community in a different way, and he's moving. He's really staying with the groups that the community that he's been established in for many years, with the men in his location and at the Falls Church. And so we're going to pray blessing on him as he steps aside from us and goes to Granny, as I like to think of the Falls Church. This is our grandmother planting church. So he's allowed, that's a direction he's allowed to go. If you're near Jeff, and yes, he is the tallest person, so you know which he is, reach your hand out towards him now. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for Jeff. I love him, and I thank you that you love him even more than I do. And Lord, he's been such a blessing to us and our community as he has been with us through these first years. Thank you for his service on Vestry. Thank you for his service, Lord, in so many unseen ways. Thank you for the way he prays and intercedes. Thank you, Lord, for all the ways that you have poured out gifts upon him, which you use for the good of your wider and greater church. Thank you that his calling is a kingdom calling, and it's a calling to reach out to people around him and say, the Lord is a God who loves you and seeks you. And Lord, we pray, will you bless him? Will you bless him in his relationships? Will you bless him in his calling? Will you bless him and make him fruitful in the ways that he engages with his neighbors and with his work colleagues? Father, we thank you that where Jeff goes, you will be there close beside him, guiding, leading, and shepherding. And so we release him to you. We release him from his obligations and responsibilities in our community. And we say, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen. And now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
And now let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia. Well, as Liz mentioned, we would love for everyone, whether you're on Zoom or here under the canopies, to linger for a short parish meeting. Also, if there's someone that you haven't met before, we would encourage you to linger and meet them, bump elbows, say hello. There is prayer at the back.
Yep.
Yes. There's a wooden table at the back that we'll clear out, and there'll be prayer available there. Otherwise, have a good week. See you all soon.